It turns out the U.S. can't actually use most of the oil that it drills from the ground. Now, I know in a world where we talk about drill, baby, drill, and energy independence, that might be surprising, but it's true. And the reasons for why that is have to do with geopolitics and history and so much more. So what exactly is going on and what does it mean? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by ERANGE EV. To really figure this out, let's set the table. The U.S. has the 10th largest crude oil reserves of any country on Earth. It's also the world's largest oil producer and the largest oil refiner on Earth. However, we can't actually use most of the oil that we produce. So, the U.S. oil production is around 12.9 million barrels per day in 2023. In December 2023, we actually reached a peak maximum for a month of 13.3 million barrels per day. And to put that into context, that's like almost 1,000 Olympic swimming pools of crude oil every single day. Now, here's a look at the oil production by different countries. And as you can see, the U.S. absolutely dominated for most of history until the 70s, when Saudi Arabia kind of took over right about there. And it's kind of gone back and forth since then, with the U.S. and Saudi Arabia kind of switching places. But again, as of 2023, the U.S. is back out in front. Now, looking at the entire world, the world produces about 104 million barrels of oil every day, and the U.S. produces 13% of that oil. Now, that's production. How about consumption? Well, the U.S. consumes 20.25 million barrels per day. We're also the largest consumers of oil in the world, and we export 4.25 million barrels per day. Then, of course, there's oil imports, what we actually buy from other countries, which is around 7.29 million barrels per day. For comparison, China, the world's largest importer, imports around 10 million barrels per day. Now, over the years, how we've gotten our oil has changed, largely due to geopolitical factors. For example, in 1973, when the U.S. aided Israel against Saudi Arabia, and many Middle Eastern countries didn't want to sell oil to us anymore, and we switched gears and started buying more from Canada. Imports from Canada make up around 3.8 million barrels per day, and Mexico is around 740,000 barrels per day. So even if where we get the oil comes from changes, it still doesn't answer the bigger question, which is, why do we export a third of what we produce and then import more than we export? That part doesn't really make that much sense, right? Also, if you take the production plus the imports and then you subtract what we export, that's around 16.35 million barrels per day, which falls short of our consumption of 20.25 million barrels per day by almost 4 million barrels of oil a day. So where does the rest come from? Well, it turns out it's coming from imports of refined products like gasoline. So not crude oil barrels, but the actual end products. We actually import that as well. And two, from refining gains. It turns out that crude oil is more dense than the final products. So by the process of refining, you actually gain around 6.5%. So the resulting oil and gasoline and diesel is actually 6.5% more voluminous than how it started. And finally, there's adjustments in inventory, which just means that you're drawing from oil that you have in reserves. The next thing we have to figure out is the refining process, because like we mentioned, crude oil is just a starting point. It's like the raw ingredient, and you buy that by the barrel. But what we actually use is refined. So what does that look like? Here is an example of a barrel of oil. And once you refine it, you have about 46% gas, 26% diesel and other fuels, 9% jet fuel, 3% asphalt, 1% lubricants, and 15% other. So if we go by today's prices, that turns out the one barrel, which cost around $70, one barrel of crude, that is, could actually be worth $140 once refined, right? So we have about $57 in gasoline, $38.50 in diesel, $23 in Jet A, and let's call it $20 for everything else. The funny thing is, we think of oil as what we need for our cars or our planes and stuff, but oil is used for so much, from pharmaceuticals to makeup, like lipstick needs petroleum. You know, and so much of our modern lives. I mean, just on this table, how many things do I have that are made out of plastic? A ton.
I make it a point to bring the amazing engineering stories happening all around us to you each and every week. For example, tires, which have come a long way. And our sponsor, ERANGE EV, makes some of the most amazing tires for your EV. Here's why. ERANGE EV's EcoPoint 3 technology means that all the rubber, filler, and compounding agents are mixed uniformly under continuous liquid phase conditions, resulting in a more consistent compound. The result? the very rare in engineering win-win-win. With better performance and grip, a quieter ride, better range thanks to lower rolling resistance, and longer life. ERANGE EV tires also feature a higher load-bearing capacity for that extra weight with your EV's batteries and incredible grip for that instant torque that EVs are known for. We even tested some of these claims by driving a total of 30 miles, 15 there and 15 back, and we found a 2 decibel drop in sound from an average of 68 on the stock tires to 66 decibels with the ERANGE EV tires. And for range, we've noticed a 5% drop, good for over 15 miles of range on a full charge. So yes, EVs are heavier, but the tires don't have to be a problem. With ERANGE EV tires, you can have a 50,000 mile warranty, quieter tires, better range, and better performance and grip. Check out the ERANGE EV line of tires, links in description, for your next set of tires for your EV. Huge thanks to ERANGE EV and you. Now back to the show.
Oil comes in handy for so many things, and selling the crude version of it is good for about $70 a barrel, but then if you buy that and then refine it, there's as much value again on the refinery side. So that's why there's so many parts to where you can make money with oil, and the U.S. takes advantage of every step along the way. The U.S. is a top oil refiner in the world, and the U.S. refining industry employs over 150,000 people and has vast, complex networks of refineries, some of the largest, most technological advanced infrastructures in the world. And we have over 130 refineries here in the U.S. with a total capacity of approximately 18.1 million barrels per day. That's almost all the crude that we use. And if you take a look at this graph here, you'll see that 3 of the largest 10 refineries on Earth are in Texas. Look at the size of some of these, like the one in here in India. But yeah, 3 of 10 are in Texas. So we're great at sucking oil out of the ground, and we're also really amazing at refining it. So then what's the problem? And it turns out it has everything to do with the type of oil that we actually extract. So here in the U.S., our proven oil reserves are around 47 billion barrels by the end of 2022. For comparison, the total global oil reserves are approximately 1.73 trillion barrels. So the U.S. is around 10th in terms of reserves. The top country, that honor goes to Venezuela. Just take a look at this. Saudi Arabia out in front early on, and then look at what Venezuela's been up to. They must have found some new oil field or come up with new technologies of extracting what they already had. And that gets something really interesting, because it wasn't always this way. Back in the 2000s, the U.S. only had around 24 billion barrels of oil in proven reserves. And back then, production was only around 6 million barrels per day, and we imported all the rest. But then something really interesting happened between 2006 and 2015, where the energy world as we know it would be turned upside down by an epic development and one of the biggest innovations and breakthroughs in the oil industry. The Barnett Shale is a natural gas reserve in the Fort Worth Basin of North Texas. It's the largest reserve in the entire U.S. We've known that for decades. The problem is that the oil and gas was trapped in tight rock formations called shale, and it's really hard to get out. George Mitchell drew on research done by the government to experiment on the Barnett Shale. He took advantage of record high oil prices and record low interest rates to develop a new drilling technique to exploit the Barnett Shale. He perfected the infamous hydraulic fracturing, or fracking. So using a combination of horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing, he let the U.S. finally tap into a massive reservoir. It catapulted the U.S. reserves to over 40 billion barrels, and it helped increase production dramatically. Thanks to the shale revolution, over 1/3 of the U.S. total crude oil production comes from shale oil. The problem is that the entire U.S. refinery system was developed for normal or conventional oil extracted from conventional oil fields, not shale. Shale oil is different and can't be processed in the same way. Shale oil is lighter than other oils, and that means that it's made of shorter hydrocarbons, which is better for fuel production. It's also sweeter, which is a funny term in the oil industry. Sweeter oil has less sulfur, which is good. Sour oil has more sulfur, which is bad. And so the U.S. mix is one of light, medium, and heavy crude oils, and some imports are specifically suited for the U.S. refinery configurations. So you might be thinking that this means that shale oil is harder to refine. But it's actually the opposite. Like we mentioned, it's lighter and it's sweeter, meaning less sulfur. So it's actually a little bit counterintuitive that the U.S. is getting higher quality oil from the ground and selling it, exporting it, and then turning around and buying heavier, sour oil from other countries. It's a process that seems backward, but it'll make off here in a second. Because the US has been refining oil for longer than pretty much anyone, our systems are old and based on the traditional, more conventional, heavier crude oil. So these refineries and machines are established and optimized for processing heavier oil. And we've developed high-tech refining methodologies over hundreds of years for this conventional stuff. We'd have to reconfigure roughly 10 to 40% of total refining capacity in the U.S. to accommodate all that shale oil that we now produce. And remember, we're the largest refiners in the world. So the type of oil that we now get has changed. How hard would it be to make those adjustments and refine what we actually extract here in the U.S. ourselves? Well, first, we'd have to reduce coking capacity, which helps break down the heavier parts of heavier crude oil. And we'd have to adjust distillation towers, which separate crude oil based on the boiling point. Also, shale oil has higher salt content, which we'd have to remove along the way. And shale oil yields more naphtha, a key ingredient in gasoline. Refineries might need to invest in upgrading reformer units and other processes to handle the increased naphtha volume. Taken individually, these aren't major challenges, but refineries are massive. And when you add up how much we'd have to do across the country or even in one 1,200-acre complex, those costs become dramatic. A refinery is like a city with interconnected processing units with vast networks of pipes, tanks, and vessels. And the largest refinery in the U.S., the Galveston Bay Refinery in Texas City, Texas, occupies 1,200 acres. That's roughly the size of 1,000 football fields. So to make changes at that scale, obviously, is going to cost a ton of money. Also, by the way, there's a difference in prices. So the shale oil that we produce is actually more expensive. So we're selling the more expensive stuff and then buying the cheaper stuff, the more heavier crude. So there's a little economic factor. But let's talk about this. This is a map of where we have refineries. You see these R's all around here, obviously a huge amount in Oklahoma and Dallas and in Texas. And then we have some here in Wyoming and on the East Coast. The blue lines are pipelines. So these are where crude oil is piped around from where it's drilled to where it actually gets processed. And then we have little rail lines to symbolize where the rail lines take crude and move it around. I bring this all up because you'll notice a pattern. Look, for example, at California. There are no pipelines going in. Now, one of the reasons for this is political. There's a lot of backlash typically with running new pipelines. You probably remember the Keystone XL pipeline, which would run all that Alberta oil from Canada down to refineries here in the U.S. That's been very controversial because pipelines are really efficient and effective, but they do leak. And if there's ever a problem and oil gets on the ground, it wreaks havoc to ecosystems. You have to remember that this stuff is incredibly valuable and our modern lives run on it, but it is something that was safely stored underground that we're now pumping up and dealing with. But there's a lot of political reasons why we don't run new pipelines or even run trains. So if you look at this map here of California, think about this. We have Texas, one of the biggest oil states on earth, but that's not where we're refining our stuff from. We are buying this from other countries that have it shipped to us by boat to these harbor locations you can see. And the same thing happens up here as well. So we actually have a situation where we drill oil, pull it out of the ground, put it in barrels, put it on tankers, and sell it to the rest of the world, and then turn right back around and buy oil from other countries that ship it to us via port. Now, this is an incredible unintended consequence of a couple of things that come together. One is globalization. The entire world now is connected. The entire world is our marketplace, and whatever you buy or sell, you can exchange and trade with the rest of the world. Two is the economics of shipping. For example, we made a video about the Panama Canal where we talked about the Panamax size vessels that used to go through the Panama Canal and how they made it bigger for the Neo-Panamax, even larger vessels. But then there's even larger vessels than that that can't fit through the Panama Canal. And we've gotten to the point where we can load up these ships with so much merchandise, in this case, barrels of oil, and we can ship it around the world and using economies of scale, do it so cheaply that it makes more sense to just buy it at a port in Long Beach, California, than it would to ship it from other parts of America. Insane stuff, but that's the world we now live in. So there's also has a couple of ramifications. The first is when anyone ever says we should drill, baby, drill to be energy independent, that's not true. It's worse than that, though. It's not just not true, it will never be true because our refineries are set up to work with heavier crude like we used to have, and we now drill, baby, drill this new shale stuff. As a result, the only people that really benefit from drilling here in America will be the oil companies and, of course, the hundreds of thousands of people that work for the oil companies as well and the shareholders of those oil companies. Now, everybody else isn't becoming more energy independent. We still need our imports from all those other countries that we've mentioned to be able to have gasoline. So if someone ever says we need to drill more locally to bring down prices, that's also not true because we aren't actually refining that much of what we make here in America. So we're still going to be at the whim of the international prices. And that gets me to the final reason why we can't make our own oil, and we never will be able to. It's because no oil company is going to make the investment to switch over to this new shale oil and invest billions to re-optimize their manufacturing and refinery processes because of the impending switch to electrification. We've probably seen peak oil in our lifetimes, and I think the demand for oil will start to fall. 1 in 5 vehicles around the world now is an electric vehicle. And in places like Norway, by the way, a huge exporter of oil, they have huge reserves, but they actually have, I think it's over 90% of new cars in Norway are electric. So they just are taking this oil out of the ground and selling it while there's still a market for it, while not really importing too much back because of how much they've shifted. Now, this is also true for Saudi Arabia, who is a huge oil country, huge exporter, made tons of money with oil, but they are turning around and using that money to invest in new sustainability initiatives. They have some of the largest solar farms, desalination plants, wind farms, offshore wind projects on Earth. So they have understood that they've been blessed with this natural resource that had value for the 19th and 20th centuries, and then are building and planning for the future. And that's the crux of this problem. We probably will just keep doing things this way. We'll keep taking whatever oil we can and shipping it out to whoever can use it, while turning around and buying the oil that we actually can refine from whoever has it. And so for this reason, there's always going to be a huge geopolitical and international component to oil prices. If you think that we're going to drill at home and have more stable oil prices, hopefully that makes it clear why that's just not going to be true. So where do you fall on this? Do you think that we should be investing and using more of our oil locally? Does it matter? I mean, it's pretty shocking, but like 10 to 20% of all the ships floating around the sea right now are carrying oil, a thing that we wouldn't have to do if we didn't have this problem, or a thing we wouldn't have to do if we moved to a world with more electric vehicles and solar. Now, natural gas will always have its place. Well, that'll be another video for another day. And oil will too. We will always need oil. Like we mentioned, pharmaceuticals, plastics, long hydrocarbon chains have value for a million reasons. But I think the instantaneous value of burning a barrel of oil as gasoline for your car will slowly go down. And eventually, there will be no economic driver for why we would drill this stuff out of the ground. And until we remove the incentive and the demand for oil, I think every country that has it, Venezuela, Norway, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, the US, Canada, will keep doing it because that's money that has an expiration date, right? Eventually, we're not going to need it anymore. And until we don't, we could keep using it. So that's a quick look at why the US doesn't actually use the oil that it drills and produces. Kind of a weird thing, but it is a really interesting consequence of the global world that we now live in. So however you're watching this, if you're watching this on YouTube, hit that like and subscribe button, join us, come check out tubadavinci.com, become a member and support us directly. If you're watching on the podcast networks, thank you for listening. Add it to your life. We'll keep these episodes coming and bring context to a world that seems at odds, which is what we do here. All right. Until next week, I'm Ricky Roy with Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.